Good to see everybody out. We got a good crowd today. Glad to see you all here. Everybody's making their way in. There we go.
We can't hear you.
Okay, I'll get louder. Maybe song. How about now? Is that better? Maybe. Good morning. Good to see everybody out, and glad you are here. I got a praise right to start with because I'm very, very proud of my church. Yesterday, we had to clean up, and I believe it's about the most people that's ever been here for a church cleanup, and I believe we had more fun than we did work. So we got a lot of work done, though, and everybody likes a bunch of little ants running around getting everything done, and place looks great. Thanks to anybody and everybody that helped doing everything. If we miss something, somebody that won't hear take care of it. No, I'm joking. If we miss something, just speak up. There you go, Tia's got it. Now, if we miss something, though, just point it out so we got another week to catch anything we didn't get. But I believe we about got everything we could think of. And so, but just appreciate everybody working so hard and working together. And especially I want to tell how proud we are of the kids, because a lot of times it's mostly just the adults, but we had a couple of kids that just worked and worked. And so thanks to them for all the hard work they did too, pushing wheelbarrows just like grown men. And so thanks for them working so hard. Anyway, anybody that helped in any way, thanks to you for doing it. And it makes our church look really well, and we just had just the best time working together. Other praises. Yes, ma'am.
I'm so thankful to be here this morning. I had a wreck. God held me in his arms, wrapped his arms around me, held me in that seat. I didn't get a broken bone. I didn't get a bad cut. I'm sore right on a little bit. But I just wish I could explain how I felt the presence of God. I did not get scared. I was Amen. Not excited. Amen. I was at peace. But God's presence was so real to me, and I praise him for it.
Amen. Thank you for saying so. Glad you're okay. Anybody else?
Miss Diane got a good
report this week. That's right. Miss Diane here didn't hear. Mr. Charlie was here yesterday. Didn't have him around in a while, so he was able to tell us all about it. But she got an excellent report after a lot of prayer and waiting, and so we're very happy for her and thankful to God for that.
Mr. Charlie said she was on cloud nine.
Yeah.
I said, why would
we
be
too?
Yeah.
What about Velva? How is she doing? Her scan came back that the tumors are shrinking. She's going to have more treatments, but at least they're shrinking. Praise God.
Other praises. Okay, let's jump to our announcements for this week. Wednesday night Bible study, 7 p.m. That's the adult Bible study. We're still in the book of Daniel. And the children's lesson will be in their classroom Wednesday night as well. Deacons meeting after that, all the deacons. Be prepared to hang around for deacons meeting. Next Sunday, of course, is our homecoming. Big Sunday here at our church every year. We'll have our service and then we'll have our meal. No food needs to be brought. That's going to be catered this year. Don't need to bring a thing. Everything's going to be just yourself. And plan to stick around and invite a friend. Be fine. So next week we have our homecoming service. Children's Church workers on the screen there you see for this week and next week. If you're not on the team and want to help with that, please see Samantha. Christmas Child is cranked up. There's papers still floating around. Table at the back's got more information about that. Any other questions, see her, and she can fill you in. We got a few weeks to get this rolling and going because they got to have time to pack the boxes and ship them. So Christmas will be here before we blink. So we got to get going on that. Anything else you need to say?
I need to.
Okay.
I need to say a couple things about homecoming. We were trying to get some numbers. I mean, we don't want anybody not to come. But if you are here today and you can't
Any other announcements?
I do, Shane. We decided in Sunday school to get back to our fourth Sunday breakfast. So fourth Sunday, 25th, we're going to have men's breakfast out here.
Okay. All right. All the guys remember that. Men's breakfast cracking back up in October.
We'll have the ladies will be cleaning the kitchen up that Wednesday night.
Leave instructions for the stove.
There you go. We'll test it out. That's right. Any other announcements? All right, let's sing a little bit.
Good morning. Let's stand together as we sing. I wonder so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside.
Yeah. Our Heavenly Father, how grateful we are that we can be here today together for worship. What a blessing it is to be with God's people. And we truly pray for your Spirit to be present in all that we do, that everything is done would be done in a way that you'll be honored and uplifted. We'll be drawn closer to you. And our earnest prayer is that there's one here today that's never trusted your Savior. This be the time they say yes to Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Take a moment and turn and greet somebody that's close to you and tell them you're glad to see them.
Thank you, Lord, for just setting us free with you. Thank you, Lord, for sending Jesus down to die for our sins. Thank you, Lord, for just letting us all be here to learn about you. Thank you, Lord, for just doing things for us when we really need it. And thank you, Lord, for just staying with us in this hard time. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
If you would, please, could you stand with me as we read God's Word? And we'll be reading this morning in 1 John 5, 1 through 13. Whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone who loves him, who begot also loves him who is begotten of him. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and keep his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For whatsoever is born of God overcomes the world, And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is he who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he who came by the water and blood, Jesus Christ, not only by water, but by water and blood, and is the Spirit who bears witness, because the Spirit is truth. For there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. And there are three that bear witness on earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three agree as one. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is the witness of God, which he has testified of his Son. He who believes in the Son of God has the witness in himself, and who does not believe, God has made him a liar, because he has not believed the testimony that God has given of his Son. And this is the testimony that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son of life, he who does not have the Son of God does not have life. And these things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. May God add to reading of his word, and you may be seated. Before we pray this morning, does any of you have any special requests or things that we should remember? Lots of unspoken this morning. You can.
The family of Steve back. Pray for the president.
Yes. Our country and the president. We absolutely need to remember this each and every day.
And our president, remember him.
Amen.
Let's pray for the president.
Yeah. If anybody wants to pray for the president, raise your hand. All right. That's exactly right.
Our neighbor, Nino Nicolosius, he's having a CAT scan to find out more about his cancer.
It's my aunt and uncle Charles, and they're still here.
We do need to remember the virus. It is real, but God will prevail. He certainly will.
Can you remember Sandy Coleman and also Michelle Brewer, that was a teacher with me, that was diagnosed with breast cancer, and she had her surgery. I remember her.
I heard from Sandy Coleman that her treatments have been postponed because she's tested positive for the virus, so you put that off.
Okay, if there's nothing else, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we come to you, but today we have many blessings that we can all share and fellowship in as a church family, dear Lord. And we are so thankful for the things that you do for us. Dear Lord, we also are made aware this morning that there are so many people in this church, in our community, that need your care, dear Lord, your loving hand. For you are the great physician, dear Lord. We're told in Scripture to come to you, dear Lord, to bring our cast all of our fears, dear Lord, all of our cares, dear Lord, to you, and you will take care of them in your own way. And we don't understand some of the things that happen here on this earth, dear Lord, but you're still in control. You're on the throne, dear Lord, and we just want to raise you up this morning. And dear Lord, as we're going into this church service, dear Lord, please take everything away from our minds, dear Lord, that will be a distraction to the Scripture, dear Lord. The Scripture in itself, dear Lord, is so powerful. It's God-breathed, dear Lord, from the beginning to the end, dear Lord. It is all written by you through man. Dear Lord, we just raise you up this morning, dear Lord. Help us to help Pastor to be a vessel, dear Lord, for everything that you want to say. Let it be said through him, dear Lord, and the way that you want it said, dear Lord. And just help us all to reflect on the things, dear Lord, that we need to make right in our own lives, dear Lord. We'll give you all the blessing and all the honor. In your name we do pray. Amen.
Good morning. It's good to see everybody, and I am glad that you are here today. Let me add my word of thanks to what Shane said for our crowd yesterday. We had a ball, and the only thing missing was we didn't cook a pig or anything, but it was. But we had a great time together and got a lot of work done, and I managed to hide most of the time. And you know, I've had some surgeries. So I was not able to do the hard work. I tried to schedule surgery right before the work day, so that always works out. You know, if you plan carefully, you can take care of things like that. But we got a lot done, though, and very grateful for that. And I'm going to tell you, this morning, I feel the presence of the Lord. And I am immensely blessed and grateful to be a part of this church. You do not realize how few people there are, it seems, in our world today that love their church, that their church is a blessing to them, an encouragement. We're not the only one by any means. But I hear people all the time saying, you know, my church is, I just don't get anything out of it. And people saying they're giving up on the church. And I say, you're going to the wrong church. Lift yourself up and come on over and share for a while. And if you begin your day as you come in for worship with a genuine heart that's open to the speaking of God's Spirit, I promise you, you're going to be blessed, and it won't be because of anything I do or any songs that we sing or anything else that's done. It'll be because God's Spirit is at work, and he will work in the weakest of vessels to accomplish great, great things if we will but allow him to. And I am so thankful and grateful for that. We've been for a few weeks now in a series of messages that we're calling Good News. We're going to wrap that up this morning. If you've noticed, each week we've been in the letter of 1 John. John wrote a letter to the churches, a letter of encouragement, a letter of instruction. It's a part of our New Testament. He actually wrote three letters. We've been looking at the first one, and we thought about some things that were a part of that you can know God. You can be forgiven for anything. You can be perfect. And then this morning, we want to wrap it up with a question. Good news, you can live forever. You can live forever. In fact, everybody's going to live forever. It's just a matter of where. You see, the Bible teaches us that every person, when they are born, that they are given a never-dying soul. And that soul is going to live for eternity someplace. And the Bible teaches us that it'll either be in the presence of God and fellowship with God in a place that we call heaven, or to be in total and complete separation from God and all that is good in a place that the Bible calls hell. And that is not a result of the fact that we are good or we are bad, or God loves some more than he loves some other, or God picks some out. It is because we do one thing, and that is that we trust Jesus Christ as our Savior. And that's what the scripture that we read this morning tells us. And I want us to think about that a little bit more. You know, everybody, that for years, people have tried to find a way to live longer or to live forever. In fact, there's a lot of history of people searching for the fountain of youth. You may, when you were in school, you might have studied about the explorer Juan Ponce de Leon. I said, my language is great there, isn't it? The accent, I love to throw a little accent in Ponce de Leon. But he was searching supposedly for the fountain of youth when he discovered Florida and then went down in the Caribbean and all that, but he never found it. But if you go back and you look long time before that, there were people that claimed to have found it. Alexander the Great claimed that he had discovered a healing river of paradise which would give a person life forever. He died at 33, by the way. So it didn't work out. I guess he didn't drink any of the water or take a bath in it, but whatever it is. And there's a lot of different things. If you look, there are nations all over the world that claim that they have found that, or secrets. And even today, if you watch TV, you know, for $19.99, you can get some supplement that's going to make you healthier and stronger and everything. The only thing, I just want to warn you about that, the $19.99 is the trial version. From then on, it's $99.99, and they will send it to you forever if you don't try to find a way to cancel your credit card and get them to quit. And the bottom line is, you know, some of these things may help you a little bit, but there's no such thing. According to U.S. Today article that was written just a few weeks ago in August the 17th of 2020, the oldest person in the world today is a man named Kanye Tanaka in Japan. He's 117 years old, and he became the oldest because a person died previous to that they said had lived longer than anybody, was 122 years old, a French woman, died in 1997. But you know what? I don't think they really know the truth, because if you pull out the Bible and you go to the book of Genesis, it tells us that in Genesis 5:27 that Methuselah lived 969 years. In fact, if you read that story, he was 187 years old when his son Lamech, who was the father of Noah, was born. So at 122, he was just a toddler. I mean, the Bible's filled with those kind of stories. But you know, in spite of that, if you read the story of Methuselah, it says he lived 969 years and he died. So whether I live 10 years, 100 years, or 1,000 years, the life of every person on this earth, if the Lord tarries, is that ultimately, physically, we're going to die. There's going to come a time that this physical body that we're walking around in ceases to live. And we die. That's the truth of the story. The average life expectancy today, if I looked up, is 78 and a half years. So if you're past that, you're living on borrowed time. If you're not quite there, you can count how many days you got left. Women live a little longer than men on average. The bottom line is nobody knows. Nobody knows what tomorrow holds. Nobody has any idea what it is. But the thing that's interesting is when you talk about life, and especially when you talk about eternal life and you talk about going to heaven, it seems that people are divided in some groups. And two of the most amazing ones to me are people who are saved and are headed to heaven, but they're not really sure about it. And the other one is people who are lost and are not going to heaven, but think they are and are pretty sure about it. You see, in our world today, most people think, if you really get down to it, that other than the really, 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 really bad people, everybody's going to heaven. Now, somehow this idea that we just kind of float around through life and you do the best you can, and when you get to the end, that somehow it works out and everybody gets to go to heaven. Now, a couple things about that. First, that's absolutely false according to the Bible. But more than that, if everybody went, it wouldn't be heaven, would it? I mean, it would be no different than life here. We'll just hang around here forever. You see, God has established that heaven is a place where He alone will be in control of everything, and it will be people who have chosen Him, who made a decision to have a relationship with Him. Well, the Universalist, for example, believes that everybody gets saved and goes to heaven, and because I'm a somebody, therefore I'm going to heaven. So it's pretty simple. I don't have to worry about it. I heard a story of a Christian man who was talking to his little son, and he asked him, he said, "Son, do you think that when you die, you will go to heaven?" He said, "Yes, sir." He said, "Well, let me ask you," because he was really talking to him about his salvation. He was old enough to begin to understand. And he said, "Let me ask you, if you died right now and you got to heaven and God said, 'Why should I let you come into my heaven?' What would you say? What would your answer be?" And the little boy said, "I'm dead." You see, that he had caught that from the world, the idea that everybody goes to heaven. Well, that's simply not true. That's simply not true. 96% of all Americans believe in God, and 79%, according to somebody who figured this out, believe in heaven. But in spite of that, if you ask people who have done everything that God requires of them to go to heaven, that is, they are saved. They have followed the teachings of God's word, that Christ died on the cross, that we accept Him in payment for our sins, the payment He made. We accept Him as our Savior, and we therefore are saved. And because of that, we're on our way to heaven. People that have done all of that. And if you ask them, "When you die, are you going to heaven?" A majority of them will answer, "I hope so. I sure hope so. I think so." Well, let me tell you this morning, John wrote a passage of scripture to those kind of people. And when we get to the end of it, I want you to be able to say, if I was to ask you, "Are you going to heaven when you die?" that you say, "Yes, sir, I know so. I know so." Well, how can you do that? Well, first of all, you have to believe what God's word says about eternal life. Listen to verse 9 of the scripture we read. "If we accept human testimony, God's testimony is greater. Because it is God's testimony that He has given about His Son." Well, a testimony is evidence given by a witness that's used a lot. We hear more of it about in a trial or anything else. But do you know that the testimony, the value of the evidence that they give, is only as good as the quality of the person giving it? So if you have a trial going on and a lawyer comes in and he knows he's losing, I mean, he knows his guy's just a guilty of sin, he knows he's losing, and somebody comes to give testimony against them, he's not going to argue the testimony. You know what he's going to do? He's going to try to disqualify the witness. He's going to find something about this guy that says you cannot believe what he is saying. Have you noticed that in our current political climate, aren't you looking forward to this being over with? In our current political climate, you hardly ever hear anybody in an ad say, "Elect me because I can do such and such." The only thing they say is, "Elect me because I'm not as bad as the other guy. The other guy's worse than I am. You can't believe anything he says, but me, that's different." Yeah, and you can believe everything I'm saying, but then he doesn't say anything. I mean, it's the same kind of thing. So here we find that John tells us you can believe the testimony because the testimony comes from God. The testimony that He has given about His Son. Now, where do we find that testimony? Well, one of the places we find in what God said about Jesus is over in the book of Matthew when Jesus came to be baptized. And listen to these verses from Matthew chapter 3, beginning in verse 16. "And when He had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to Him. And He saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon Him. And suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, 'This is My beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.'" God Himself testifies that Jesus is His Son. Now, you have a choice to make. Either you will believe what God says about Jesus, and therefore what he says about how Jesus is the way for eternal life, or you will not. You see, the very beginning of everything about our relationship with God comes down to whether we believe that God is telling the truth, whether we believe that God is honest. And sadly, there are too many people in the world that choose not to do that. Listen to verse 9 again. If we accept human testimony, God's testimony is greater. Do you realize that every day that passes, we accept the testimony or the word of people that we don't even know? We don't even know. You go to the doctor and they diagnose you and say, you've got some heart problems. And here's some medication that's going to help. And so they write a prescription. And you run down to the pharmacy and they bring you a little bag out and say, that'll be $99.99, $99.99. Unless you got insurance, then we'll take a dollar off. And here's your little bag of stuff, and it's going to be a miracle drug. And you take it. And the truth is, all they did was they went down to the candy aisle and got some pills and put it in a bottle and gave it to you, and you believed them and gave them $99 for it. Well, you hope that's not true, don't you? You hope that what they're giving you is what they say they're giving you, but I don't have any idea. They could give me something that's going to kill me. I'd take home and swallow the thing. You see, you believe them. If you start to fly an airplane, which I wouldn't do nowadays, but if you got to fly somewhere and you go get on an airplane, when you start up, they got a guy wearing a little blue suit that's got little wings on it and a fancy little cap. And you believe he knows how to fly the plane. Why? Because sure they wouldn't give him that outfit if he couldn't fly. To be sure, somewhere along the way, somebody checked to see if he actually knows how to fly a plane, and you jump on and buckle your seatbelt and take off, and he may have never been on a plane before. But you believe what they told you. And you see what John is saying, if you believe people, if you believe the testimony of man, you sure can believe the testimony of God, because the testimony of God is far more secure than that. In fact, verse 9 again the New Living Translation says, since we believe human testimony, surely we can believe the testimony that comes from God. It is, in other words, he's saying, when you consider the quality of the testimony, it's based on who gives the testimony. You can believe what God says. Well, obviously, our world is filled with people that don't believe what God says because they're not saved. They're not saved. If I try to witness to a person and I talk to them about the Lord, the first thing we have to establish is that you believe the Bible is God's word. Because if you don't believe the Bible is God's word, then we're just going to talk about what I think and what you think. If you believe the Bible is God's word, we're going to talk about what you think and what God said. And what I think doesn't really make any difference. And the truth is, what you think doesn't either. But the testimony is that. So listen to what John says in verse 10. The one who believes in the Son of God has this testimony within himself. In other words, that truth is in you. The one who does not believe God has made him a liar, because he has not believed in the testimony God has given us about his Son. You see, if somebody says, I believe that I can go to heaven by being good, what he's saying really is, I believe Jesus was a liar when he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father but by me. Either that's true or it's not. Either Jesus is honest or he's a liar. When God tells us you're going to spend eternity in one of two places, and the only way to go to heaven is to trust Christ as your Savior, you believe that. And that testimony is within you, and you accept Christ as your Savior, or you decide to believe something else. And when you believe the something else, I don't care what it is, you have decided to believe somebody more than to believe God. Now, friend, I'm going to tell you, I know a lot of smart people. I know a lot of people that have all kinds of knowledge and evidence, and they're geniuses in all kinds of ways and everything, but they're not smarter than God. And if they believe they are a fool. And if I follow them, I'm gonna reap a sad reward for it. And yet our world is full of people that get up in the morning and read the newspaper and listen to the news on television or go to the internet or whatever and believe all this junk that's being peddled out there, And they say it sounds good to me. You know why it sounds good to a person that's lost? Because it says you can keep on doing what you're doing. I don't want to stop sinning. I don't want to stop living that way. I want to keep on being the person I am. So if somebody tells me, don't worry, you're just fine like you are, they're going to love that. They're going to love that. And they're going to roll right along with it. The problem is, it's a lie. It is a lie. 1 John 5:11. And this is what God has testified. He has given us eternal life. And this life is in His Son. And so if you want to have eternal life, if you want to experience eternal life, the first thing you have to do is get your facts straight. You have to believe what God's Word says about eternal life. Well, the second thing you have to do is you have to receive God's Son who can give you eternal life. You see, one of the saddest things in the world is that there are people who really do believe there is a God. They believe that God is good. They even read the Bible and they say, yeah, I believe what the Bible says. I believe it's God's Word. They even somewhere along the way have heard a preacher preach about Jesus dying on the cross for our sins. And as a result of that, we can go to heaven. And they believe that. But they never did anything about it. They never did anything about it. It would be kind of like, in a crude example, what I said a minute ago, I go to the doctor and he prescribes a medicine for my illness, and I go by the drugstore and I pick up my pills and I take them home, but I never take them. And somebody says, why aren't you taking them? I say, well, I'm saving them for a rainy day. I might get sick one day and then I'll use them. You are sick. You are sick. And a person that does that, they have taken the first step, that is they believe, but they have to take the second step, and that is to receive. Listen to verse 12. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have God's Son does not have life. You can't put it any plainer, can you? You cannot put it any plainer. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have God's Son does not have the life. If you don't have Jesus in your heart, I don't care how healthy you are, I don't care how rich you are, how powerful you are, or who you are, you're a dead man walking. When you leave today, you'll be riding home in a hearse. You say, well, wait a minute, preacher. My heart's still beating. I checked my blood pressure this morning. It was a little bit high, if anything. I got plenty of activity going on here. My brain is still working. I can hear you. I know what you're saying. Yeah, you can, but you're missing the thing that makes you alive. You see, blood to the human body is life. If you lose your blood, you will die. Your blood is life. Well, the same thing is true spiritually. Jesus Christ is life to your spirit. John, in his gospel in chapter 10, verse 10, put it this way: the thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. So let me ask you, you probably want eternal life and you probably want to go to heaven, but who are you trusting on to get you there? What are you trusting to get you there? You see, if you say, well, in 1973, I got baptized. Well, good for you. Good for you. You might say, I'm a member of the church. I got a little certificate they gave me when I joined the church. Good. Why don't you join 7 or 8 churches? You can join every church there is in the United States. Put your name on all the rolls. You can say, well, you know, I came out yesterday and helped to work there at the church. You know, that's got to count for something. And I visited somebody the other day, took some food to somebody that was sick. Every week I write my check and put a little money in the offering plate. I believe in God. I'm very sincere in what I believe. You see, all those things are things that people say and actually believe are ultimately going to get them into heaven. They believe that when they show up at heaven's door, they're going to be there and they're going to look and say, well, let's see, your name's not on the list. They say, yeah, but I got all these tokens. I collected tokens along the way. Oh, yeah, well, we take them. Come on in. Come on in. Or I got some money in my hip pocket. If you think you can carry it with you, good luck with that too. But the bottom line is, none of those things will give you eternal life. The only way that you can have eternal life is to receive God's Son, Jesus Christ, who he says is eternal life. You've probably seen a church sign somewhere along the way that had this on it: no Christ, no life. No Christ, no life. Absolutely true. Absolutely true. God has made a statement about eternal life, and we must believe what his word says, and his Son is the way for that, and we must receive him. And if you do those two things, if you believe what God's word says and you receive God's Son, then you can do a third thing, and that is you can live each day with confidence that you have eternal life. In other words, you can know that you know that you know that you are a Christian. Live each day with confidence you have eternal life. Listen to verse 13. These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. Now, John says there's two things that happen as a result of what he's trying to teach us in this writing. The first one is you can know that you have eternal life. If you have done the things that he says that are there, that is, believe Christ, believe God, believe his word, and you have accepted him as your Savior, then you can know that you have eternal life. And let me tell you, one of the strangest things to me is people who believe God's word that Jesus died on the cross to pay for our sin. And they believe when he died on the cross to pay for our sins, that if they accept him, they can get saved. But then they believe that if I mess up, he kicks me out of the club. I get unsaved. And so when that happens, I got to go back through this again. And so they live their life in abject fear all the time that something's going, I'm going to get hit by a truck between the time that I sinned and the time I got saved again. And these people in their mind are getting saved over and over and over and over again. And I'm saying, good gracious, what kind of God do you serve who is so capricious that he would save you one minute and have you kicked to the curb the next? And what that really says is, I do not believe that the blood of Christ shed on the cross of Calvary is adequate to save me. You see, it takes, in their mind, it takes the blood of Christ on the cross of Calvary plus my good works. And once I get saved, I got to really try to stay saved. Now, I believe once you get saved, you ought to really try to show the world that you're saved. You ought to really try to live in a way that you say to God every day, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for giving your life on the cross of Calvary so I can live. Thank you. And my life is lived as an offering to you. Paul talks about giving our lives as a living sacrifice to him, because of what he has done, but it does not purchase it for us. It instead is simply an offering of thanks for what he has already done. I heard about a little boy one time who was standing side the road. Man drives up in a fancy car there, and he rolls down the window, and he says, son, do you know how to get to town? And the little boy says, nope. He said, well, do you know where Route 20 is? He said, nope. He said, well, do you know where this road I'm on right here goes? He said, nope. He said, well, do you know what the name of this road is? He said, nope. And the man said, well, son, you don't know much, do you? He says, I know I ain't lost. I'm going to tell you, there may be things that you don't know in life, but you can know that you are not lost. You can know that you are not lost. The word believe is more than just to believe something in your head. It is to be committed to something in your heart. Believe what God's word said about eternal life. Receive God's Son who can give you eternal life, and then live every day with confidence that you have that eternal life. Now, some people teach that if you can't tell the exact day and the exact time and the exact place that you got saved, you're not saved. Well, I know that I know that I know I'm saved, and I know where it happened, And I was 6 years old, but I can't tell you what day it was, because when I was six, I was not keeping a calendar. I even wrote back to the church, and they're not sure. So if they weren't keeping up with it, how was I supposed to keep up with it? And I'm not 6 years old. But I know that it happened. And some people say, well, you know, if you can't remember that, I'm glad my salvation is not based on my memory, because every day that passes, my memory gets worse and worse and worse. Some days I couldn't remember my phone number. Of course, I never call myself, so I don't need to. But it's like, let me ask you a question. If you're a Christian and you're saved and you know that you're saved, there's no question that you're saved, and you're in an automobile accident, or you get Alzheimer's, or something happens to you, and you lose your memory. You can't remember anything at all. Does that mean you're not saved now because you can't remember? Of course it does not. Of course it does not. You are saved because you have trusted Christ as your Savior. And if in your heart you know that you've done that, that is not a transaction like you get stamped on your hand or something when you get through, you get a certificate or anything else. It is a heart transaction where within your heart you turn to God and you say, God, I know that I'm a sinner. I know that I don't deserve to go to heaven, and I never can deserve to go to heaven, but I believe that you love the world, as you said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. I believe that. And I believe Christ died on the cross for our sins, and I believe that he was resurrected the third day. I believe he's ascended, he's in heaven right now, and he's putting the finishing touches on a home for us. And because I believe that, Christ, I invite you to come into my heart. Jesus, come into my heart. Cleanse me of my sin. Forgive me of my sin. Help me to be the person that you want me to be. Help me to be better than I am. Help me to work toward being that perfect person I ought to be. And I believe that because of that, that one day, whether it's tomorrow, whether it's 100 years from now, when I lay down in death, that I will be transported from this place to the presence of the Lord. And that's the greatest assurance that you can ever have. You see, I have a birth certificate, got a copy of it. It's recorded at the courthouse. Up there, if you look it up, it says on May the 19th of 1954, Tim Stevens was born, 66. I know I don't look it, but 66 years ago. And that's proof that I am who I say I am. And sometimes when you do something, they want to see your birth certificate. I got one. But I'm glad that my name is not only written down in that book at the courthouse, but I'm glad my name is written in the book of life. And that's the one I'm counting on for eternal life. Friend, if you don't know that, if you're not sure that, you can today. You can trust Christ as your Savior, and on the authority of God's Word, he will save you, and he will give you the gift of eternal life. Let's pray. God, we thank you that you have given us the privilege to trust your Savior. Oh, we thank you, Lord, that you were willing to go to the cross and there to give your life that we might have life. And I pray, Lord, that you will help us to understand the truth of that. And if, in fact, we've trusted you in that way, then to live with the assurance in our heart that one day we're going to heaven. And not only is eternal life something that we have one day, Lord, but it's something we have right now. We are alive in Jesus Christ. We thank you for that. And Lord, I pray now if there's one here today or one perhaps listening by video that has never trusted your Savior, that maybe this will be the time they say yes to Jesus. For each of us, help us to trust you with the needs that we have, whatever they might be, the questions, the concerns. Trust you in all things and seek to live for you. Forgive our sin in Jesus' name. Amen. You have a need, whatever it might be, invite you to bring it to the Lord as we stand together and sing.
continuing our Bible study. We're continuing the study of Daniel. We're in the 9th chapter, and I encourage you to be there for that. You men that are deacons, remember, deacons meeting following that, and then next Sunday, homecoming. We'll be here for Sunday school worship service at their regular times, and then enjoy fellowship together around the tables. Encourage you to be here and invite anybody you know, especially former members maybe that might be aware of it. Invite them to come join with us for the fellowship and for the time together. Anything before we close? Ted, would you lead us in a closing prayer, please?
Our Father God, we thank you for the blessing of being here and listening to your word. As we go from this place, we ask that you be with each one, be with each family. Forgive us our sins and be with those on prayer this Lord. And bring us together again for our next church activity. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.